So welcome back. We are meeting after a long time, around 2 weeks after we are meeting, I suppose. So, but we are starting with a new topic, so that's not an issue. But then too, I'll just relate with the previous topic which we have studied, because this new topic, which is asymmetric key cryptography, is related with symmetric key cryptography which we studied last time. Okay, so let's just revise it in 2 minutes. So what we saw in symmetric key cipher or symmetric key cryptography, first we defined plain text and cipher text. So again, these terms are important, so we'll again revise them. So the original message, which is in normal form, is called as what? Plain text. And the message that is sent through the channel, or through the insecure channel rather, is called the cipher text. And to create the ciphertext from the plain text, we use an encryption algorithm and a shared secret key. So this term is very important here, shared secret key. Okay, so, and to create the plain text from ciphertext, Bob uses a decryption algorithm, and this is the most important term, which is same secret key. So because of this same key, the name is what? Symmetric key cipher. So we understood it very easily with the help of this diagram. So I'll just zoom into it using slideshow. So this is Alice, this is Bob. So Alice wants to send a message to Bob. So he has the message in the form of plain text, obviously, but it is a very secure message, so he wants it to send very securely. So what it does, he uses encryption. And which form of encryption is he using? He is using symmetric key cryptography. So what do you mean by symmetric key cryptography? The key which is there is same for encryption as well as decryption. That's why it is called as symmetric key cryptography, right? So plain text using an encryption is given is an input encryption algorithm along with the shared secret key. So from this, the algorithm works out a cipher text which is sent through an insecure channel and which is sent to Bob. So using the same secret key, the decryption algorithm takes the input as cipher text and the key and generates the plain text again. Right? So this is the example of symmetric key cryptography. And what is the important thing here? That if you think in terms of padlocks, so this is getting locked using this key, so that is encryption algorithm. And for the decryption, for unlocking, we are using a decryption algorithm and the same key. So you see the both the keys are same here. So this is the idea behind what symmetric key cryptography. So now let's move to our actual topic for today, which is asymmetric key cryptography, right? So you might have got an idea what we mean by asymmetric key cryptography, but let's proceed. So symmetric key cryptography, as we saw, it is fast and efficient. Okay, so why is it fast and efficient? That point also I'll touch upon in the further slides. However, there is a problem associated with symmetric key cryptography. And what is the problem? It suffers from a big disadvantage of problem of key exchange. Okay, the sender and receiver of an encrypted message use the same key in symmetric key cryptography, and it is very tough to agree upon a common key without letting anyone else know about it. So it can be proved using an example that it is very tough to agree upon a common key. Okay, so for that you can refer books, or if I have time, I'll take it later. So asymmetric key cryptography solves this problem. So each communicating party uses two keys to form a key pair. So one key, which is called the private key, remains with the party, and the other key, the public key, is shared with everybody. So as the name suggests, it is public, so everyone knows about that key. So these are the two keys used, that's why it is called as asymmetric key cryptography. So as I said, the keys are two separate keys, one private and one public. So if encryption and decryption are thought of again as locking and unlocking padlocks, as we saw in the last PPT with keys, then the padlock that is locked with a public key can be unlocked only with the corresponding private key. Now this is important. First thing which we observe here is we are using different keys for locking and unlocking. And for locking we are using a public key. So a lock or a padlock rather is always locked with a public key. And when we means it is in for the encryption algorithm, what is the input? The public key and the plain text, you can say. But while decrypting, for the decryption algorithm, what is the input? Not the public key, but the private key and the ciphertext. Okay, So for locking always, or for the encryption side always public key is used, and for decryption side always private key is used. So this is very important. So the figure which you will see in the previous slide, further slide, will show this concept. So this is Alice, this is Bob. So Alice wants to send a message to Bob. Okay. So what you see again, Alice has to have the public key of Bob. So he uses Bob's public key. So how he knows the key? Because it is known to public, it is available in the key distribution channel. What is key distribution channel? We'll see in something. So it is available publicly in the key distribution channel. So Bob, Alice takes it and locks it using this public key, and that is our encryption algorithm. And it, so once it is locked, we get a ciphertext. So that is sent through any insecure channel. So it is arrived here. So then he wants to decrypt it. Bob wants to decrypt it. So he uses a decryption algorithm, and he uses a different key. What is that key? He uses his own private key. So what is the advantage of this? It is Bob's private key, right? So only Bob knows about key, that key. Not even Alice knows about that key. Alice only knows about Bob's public key. He does not know about the private key of Bob. He does not know about the private key of Bob. Means what I want to say is, does not know the contents, or what is the key, or what are the numbers here in. So this is the way asymmetric key crypto system or asymmetric key cryptography works. Okay. So this is, diagram shows a very general idea of the asymmetric key cryptography. Again, Alice wants to send a message to Bob. So you can use this diagram in the exam also. So I have a plain text. So we use an encryption algorithm. So what you see here, the key is taken from here, in fact. As I said, this is the public key distribution channel. Okay, so this is available publicly to everyone. Okay, so but even though it is available public key, we require authentication and integrity here. So why, that we'll see in the further slides again. So from the public key distribution channel, so let's start from the beginning. So Alice wants to send a message to Bob, but it is a very confidential message, so they want it to send securely. So they rely on encryption. And they rely on, or they select asymmetric key cryptography. So Alice has this plain text. So since they are relying on or depending on asymmetric key cryptography, they require two keys. One is public key and private key. Now, a fact about the asymmetric key cryptography is, who is the receiver here? Bob. So the keys of Bob only will be used here. Neither the public key of Alice nor the private key of Alice will be used in this, because he is the transmitter. So that is the way this method or this cryptography technique works. So since Bob is the receiver, his keys only will be used. So since Bob is the receiver, he has a public key and a private key. So from the public key distribution channel, Alice takes the public key, uses his encryption algorithm, encrypts it, and generates the ciphertext, and he sends it through any insecure channel. So the ciphertext is received by Bob. So Bob uses a decryption algorithm, and Bob has his own private key, right? So he gets that from key generation procedure. So that key generation procedure for Bob, it generates a public key and a private key. Now there is a relation, remember, between the public key and the private key. So if you have, say, a third person, Eve, or a third person, let's say Vilas or someone else, he will also have a public key and private key. So if you take that Vilas person's private key and use here, it will not work. Since the message is encrypted using Bob's public key, we should have Bob's private key only. Neither Alice's private key nor anyone else's private key will work. Only Bob's private key will work here. So that is the advantage of using this asymmetric key cryptography. So once we have both these things, we can use the decryption algorithm to get the plaintext. So that is the crux of the asymmetric key cryptography. So let's see what are the intricacies of this. So as I said, the burden of providing security is mostly on the shoulders of the receiver, Bob in this case, right? So although the public key distribution channel is not required to provide secrecy because it holds the public key, but it must provide authentication and integrity. Now why is the case? So let's take the example of a third person. So we have Alice and Bob sending messages. If there is a third person, let's say Eve, so he should not be able to advertise her public key to the community pretending that it is Bob public key. So if you say there is no authentication and integration, it will generate a problem of repudiation, as we saw in the previous lectures, right? So you should not be able to advertise her public key to the community pretending that it is Bob's public key. So that is the thing, that is the reason we also require authentication and integrity. So then asymmetric key cryptography means that Bob and Alice cannot use the same set of keys for two-way communication, right? So as I said, the onus is on the receiver. So Alice sends to Bob, so Bob's keys are used. If Bob wants to send a message to Alice, so whose keys will be used? Alice keys will be used, right? So it is not, so the same keys, so that's what this sentence is saying, cannot use the same set of keys for two-way communication. So how Alice can use Bob public key to send encrypted messages to Bob, that we saw in the previous figure. But now if Bob wants to respond to Alice, so Alice needs to establish her own private and public keys, right? So these keys will require, as I said, will be required in fact. So then asymmetric key cryptography means that Bob needs only one private key to receive all correspondence from anyone in the community, right? So if Alice is here, instead of Alice, if Eve wants to send the message to Bob, so again this diagram will be same, because Bob's key is used here, also Bob's key is used, only the message might change. So accordingly ciphertext will change, but the keys will be same since Bob is the receiver again, right? So that is what this sentence is saying. Bob needs only one private key to receive all correspondence from anyone in the community, but Alice needs n public keys to communicate with n entities in the community, one public key for each entity. If you have not understood this, it is very simple from taking the example of a bank. So if I have a bank and it has three customers A, B and C, right? So they want to do some transaction, obviously it should be secure, so they want to use the secure channel to tell the bank that we have to do so and so transaction, let's say debiting of some amount. Okay, so what does bank do? It sends it public key, is public everywhere, so bank gives its public key, right? So A, B and C, all the three customers have the public key, right? So what do they do? The customer A encrypts, use the encryption algorithm along with the public key to generate a ciphertext. Same is done by B, same is done by C. Okay, remember all three messages will be different, so corresponding ciphertext will also be different, right? So these are sent to the bank. So bank has got the three messages. So what it does, since they were encrypted with the bank's public key, so they can only be decrypted with the bank's private key. So they get decrypted, so bank can read the message and perform the transaction, right? So what is happening here? What we saw here, Alice needs n public keys to communicate with n entities in the community, right? So in the same way, we are having here three public keys, right? For three persons, right? So Alice needs n public keys to communicate with n entities in the community, right? So what it is saying is, if A wants to communicate with X, Y and Z, so A is communicating with bank here, so it has got bank's public key. Let's say it wants to communicate with X person, person X, so it will require X public key. If it wants to communicate with Y, it will require Y's public key. So three persons, three public keys. So in the same way, N persons, N public key. So that is the understanding of that statement. So then, what we saw in symmetric key cryptography, we studied transposition cipher and substitution cipher. So we saw they are nothing but trying to confuse the attacker so that he is confused and not able to decrypt the messages. So and we saw in DES and EES that permutations and combinations are used on a large scale. So basically in symmetric key cryptography, symbols are used and they are permuted or substituted, right? But what happens in asymmetric key cryptography is numbers are manipulated. Instead of symbols, we don't have symbols at all, we have numbers only. So that is the main difference in here. So then one key is used for encryption and only the other corresponding key, again remember this is very important, must be used for decryption. So one public key is used for encryption and the private key must be used for decryption. So this can be your term test question again, if you have again having MCQ type of questions. So no other key can decrypt the message, as I said earlier, not even the original, that is this public key cannot decrypt again. So what is the beauty of this scheme? That every communicating party just needs a key pair for communicating with any number of other communicating parties. So this is just a statement showing this only. Bob needs only one private key to receive all correspondence from anyone in the community. That is just saying this same statement. So now we saw that here numbers are getting manipulated, right? So let's understand with the help of an example why numbers are used. So if you have an extremely large number that has only two factors, which are prime numbers obviously. So if a number has only two factors, it is obviously a prime number. So you can generate a pair of keys. So this scheme is used in generating public and private keys. So for example, consider a number 10. So number 10 has only two factors again. So 5 and 2, right? So in this case, it is not a prime number, right? So it has two factors, 5 and 2. So if you apply 5 as an encryption factor, only 2 can be used as the decryption factor. Because if you are using factorization method, 10 has only two factors. So if you have selected 10 as a number, and if you select 5 as the encryption factor, so if you want to calculate the decryption factor from these three numbers, you don't know the third number, you know the two numbers, so you can calculate. So only 2 will be the answer, right? So only 2 can be used as the decryption factor, right? So not even 5 itself can do the decryption. So that is what is being explained here. So this sentence is getting explained here. But of course, 10 is a very small number. So in practice, 10 will not be used. A very large number, more than 100 digits actually, will be used. So with minimal effort, this scheme can be broken into, because this number is small. So if the number is very large, it is observed that even years of computation cannot break the scheme. And that is a fact. And that is why this asymmetric key cryptography is still used today. So this is the differences between the symmetric key and asymmetric key. So you can just go through this. So it can be asked in the exam. So let's start with the first algorithm or the first technique which we use in asymmetric key cryptography. So it is the RSA algorithm, named after Rivest, Shamir and Adelman. So RSA, and they published the results this in 1978. So it is based on the mathematical fact that it is easy to find and multiply large numbers together. For example, it is easy to multiply 5 into 2 to get 10. But it is extremely difficult to factor their product. So, and those numbers on top of that are prime numbers only. So that is the importance here. Okay. So what is it saying? The number which you are selecting may not be a prime number, but the number should have only two factors which are always prime. So that is the important thing here. So the private and public keys in RSA are based on very large, made up of 100 or more digits, as I said, and they are only prime numbers. But the algorithm is actually simple. But what is the challenge in RSA is to the generation and selection of public and private keys. So how this is done, we'll understand. So in example, you get a straightforward question. Explain RSA algorithm with an example. So let's see that. Oops, I missed the actual algorithm, I suppose. Okay, anyways, yeah. So this is just the example, but this first points which you see is the algorithm, okay? So make sure you first write the algorithm and then give the example. Again, I am repeating, if in the exam you get this question, so you first write the algorithm, 1, 2, 3 points, and then you write the examples which are given in boxes, okay? So first step is choose two large numbers, prime numbers P and Q. So what is the thing that you should choose prime numbers only, and they should be large. But since we are seeing an example, so we'll take relatively small numbers, let's say 47 and 17. So as we said, these numbers are actually of 100 digits or more. So you can imagine the complexity. So even the fastest computer in the world will take years to compute or to decrypt the message using ATAX. So the numbers are 47 and 17. Calculate a number n, which is a multiplication of p and q. So 7 into 17 will give you 190. Then select the public key, that is the encryption key E, such that it is not a factor of P minus 1 times Q minus 1. So if you are having a doubt, sir, why use this method only? Why not use P minus 2, Q minus 2? Now this is the algorithm which is presented by Rivest, Shamir and Adelman. So that's why we are using this procedure. If you want, you can use P minus 2, Q minus 2, that will be a different algorithm, right? So P minus 1, Q minus 1 karna, right? So let us find first, so P is 47, they have written here, but it is actually 7. So you can make the change. So 7 minus 1 and 17 minus 1. So 6 into 16 is 96. So select the public key such that it is not a factor of this multiplication, which is 96. So it should not be a factor of 96. So what are the factors of 96? 2 times 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 times 2 and 3, right? Because 96 is this number. Multiply 2 5 times and multiply that number by 3 as well. So these factors cannot be used. So choose E such that none of the factors of E is 2 and 3. So for example, if you choose E as 4, what are the factors of 4? 2 and 2. So since, but you don't want the factor as 2, so discard it. Similarly, if you take 15, 3 is a factor of 15, so it can't take it because 2 and 3 have to be discarded. So let's take E as 5. So again, this will be a large number which will be selected. And again, it can be any other number, but for simplicity and assumption, you have taken as 5. So then what does RSA people say? They say, select the private key, that is the decryption key D, such that the following equation is true. So you have P, so you can find P minus 1, you have Q, so you can find Q minus 1, you have E. Then assume D, find D such that this equation is satisfied. Okay. So then we have E as 5. So D into 5 mod, we already saw this multiplication is 96. So 5D mod 96 is 1. So after some calculations, doing some iterations, will get D as 77. So 77 into 5 mod 96 will give you 385 mod 96. So what does this equation do? It takes the remainder. Okay. So if you find the remainder is 1, which is what we want, because this equation should come out to be 1. So that's why, so we have selected this D as 77 because it gives the remainder as 1. Okay. So this can be done using 2 or 3 steps. So that are not required to be shown. So you can just, you will have to remember this number. So for encryption, we calculate the ciphertext. How we calculate it? Plain text raised to E mod N. Okay, so N we have got in the step number 2. So it is 119. So 10 raised to 5 mod 119. See, plain text can be anything. So we have assumed it to be 10. So 10 raised to 5 mod 119. So it is 1 lakh mod 119. So if you calculate this, the remainder will be 40. So this is what ciphertext. So send 40 as ciphertext to the receiver, right? So then for calculating the plain text, it is CT raised to D mod N. Remember, D is the decryption key, so it is used in the exponent. Here E is the encryption key, so it is used in the exponent. So CT is 40, as we saw. So 40 raised to 77 mod 119 is 10. If you calculate, you will get it as 10. So which was the original plain text which you got in step 5. So this is the RSA algorithm. So as I said, in the exam you first write this 7 steps and then you show the example. Okay. So then, although no successful attacks on RSA have been reported so far, chances of such attacks happening in the future have not been ruled. So can you think of what might be the reasons that the chances will go on increasing as time passes? The simple reason is that the strength of the computations becomes faster, right? Because the processing power also increases, right? So the simple example is, till last year or 1 or 2 years ago, we had 3 types of processors from Intel: i3, i5 and i7, but recently i9 has been released, right? So it has obviously more processing power than i5, i7 and i3, right? So that is the reason. So as we progress further, so the decryption which was taking years might take months. Right, so it might be a problem, right? So even though no attacks have been performed, we still study the potential attacks on them. And these are the attacks: factorization, chosen ciphertext, encryption and exponent, which has these subtypes, and so on. Okay. And a very important thing, this question has not been asked so far in the last 3 papers. So you can expect this as almost guaranteed question: explain RSA algorithm with example, or a numerical based on that we'll take in the next lecture. Okay, so we'll stop here.